celebrate the 14th Sunday of Ordinary Time. This Mass is offered for the repose of the souls of Dorotea Margallo and Maria Teresa Bayat-Langloga, and for Pro Populo. Before we proceed, if you have a cell phone or another mobile device and you're not sure if it's on, please take this opportunity to turn it off or into some sort of silent mode. Thank you very much. So that we may worship as a community of friends and not strangers, let's all stand and, while maintaining proper social distancing, greet one another in the spirit of Christ.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heaven king, O God, our mighty Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Lord. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, and the glory of God the Father. O God, who in the abasement of your Son have raised up a fallen world, fill your faithful with holy joy. For on those who have rescued from slavery to sin, you bestow eternal gladness. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and forever.
Amen.
Reading from the book of the prophet Zechariah. Thus says the Lord, rejoice heartily, O daughter Zion. Shout for joy, O daughter Jerusalem. See, your king shall come to you. A just savior is he, meek and riding on an ass, on a colt, the foal of an ass. He shall banish the chariot from Ephraim and the horse from Jerusalem. The warrior's bow shall be banished, and he shall proclaim peace to the nations. His dominion shall be from sea to sea, and from the river to the ends of the earth. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, you are not in the flesh. On the contrary, you are in the Spirit, if only the Spirit of God dwells in you. Whoever does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. If the Spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, the one who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also, through his Spirit that dwells in you. Consequently, brothers and sisters, we are not debtors to the flesh to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. The word of the Lord.
Yes, Father, such has been your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son wishes to reveal him. Come to me, all you who labor and are burdened, I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am meek and humble of heart, and you will find rest for yourselves. For my yoke is easy and my burden light. The Gospel of the Lord.
Thank you. Sisters and brothers, you and I are, even now, in the very midst of celebrating the 4th of July weekend. Yesterday, of course, was Independence Day. And when we think of Independence Day, well, certainly we think of freedom. Our history books, at least during my time in school, spoke of taxation without representation. That the American country, these United States, which was then only a few colonies, were governed by, as you know, Great Britain. And they incurred a very heavy tax, but they had no voice. That should bring a certain sound in the hearts of every single one of us who calls and know ourselves to be Christians. And in a very particular way, those of us who practice, truly practice this Catholic faith. We have, even before we have a voice, we have a word. And that word has become flesh in Jesus Christ. And this Jesus Christ, with his word, by his word, with his voice, proclaims to us all the mysteries of the kingdom of God. And Jesus Christ, by the love of God and the grace of the Holy Spirit, teaches us all that we need to know about freedom. That is all that you and I need to know about love. What Jesus Christ reveals to us is a certain truth. And this truth is emblazoned in so many of our national hymns. You might recall that in the Battle Hymn of the Republic, we sing, "Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He has trampled out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He has loosed the fateful lightning of his terrible swift sword." And he goes on to say that his truth is marching on. This, brothers and sisters, is what you and I seek, and what we discern and what we find in a sure and certain God. Truth. In the 104th Psalm, and before I go on, I want to thank Michael and Scott for that incredibly wonderful responsorial song. It was so moving in so, so many, many ways that you and I must come to praise the name of the Lord forever, because he is our King and because he is our God. But in the 104th Psalm, we read this: "I will sing to the Lord all my life. I will make music to my God while I live. May my very thoughts be pleasing to God, because I find all of my joy in God." We pray, David prayed, that sinners might vanish from the earth and that the wicked would no longer exist. And then he ends the psalm by praying, "Praise the Lord, my soul. I am, according to me, a great creature of habit. I came down this morning and I went outside to collect the paper. I've always gotten a lot of news from the morning paper, because when I grew up, there was just one newspaper, the Virginian Pilot, and everyone read it. But I sought to read the news with discernment, to read it looking for what was true and learning how to reject what wasn't. The same thing became true when I began to watch the news. At that time, there were only three major networks, and we would always watch the news on one. But again, to receive the news, but in receiving the news, to be able to discern what was essential and what was not essential. Now, the same thing is true, isn't it? About the good news, about the gospel, that we must learn how to receive it, to hear it, and discern its meaning, not only for ourselves, but also for our time. And we have, once again, in Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit, and by the will of the Father, the grace to hear his word and to put this word into practice. There is a particular word that strikes me today, just as there were particular words on the front page of the Post today that struck me. I was struck with these headlines, which are partial, which say that a virus cases take no holiday. And so we live in the midst of a virus. It also went on to say in another article, Americans converging on DC question freedom's meaning. Freedom's meaning. And the nation on its birthday, ailing and divided, but hopeful. Ailing, divided, hopeful. And there was another article that spoke about racial animus. This, brothers and sisters, is the world in which you and I live. These are our times. And according to me, these times are not very different from the times of Jesus Christ. Nor are they likely very different from the times that are to come. There will always, always, always be tensions. And there will always be viruses, whether they are of our bodies, our minds, and our spirits. We will always need to discern for ourselves and for our age the meaning of what it means to be free. And you and I, through the lens of faith, we have a view that others don't have. Because we know that what it means to be truly free is to be free from sin, so that we can live freely as children of God. And nations, like our own, will always experience some type of ailment, some type of division. There will always be some type of animus, whether it's racial or financial. These things have always been a part, not of creation, but a part of what you and I, by sin, bring into creation. Now, with all of this seemingly negative news, and realizing that it's been present throughout the history of salvation, still the prophet Zechariah says to us today, rejoice heartily. Shout for joy. Your king shall come to you. He is a just savior. He is meek. And here is the point that I hope that you will experience today. He shall proclaim peace to the nations, and his dominion will be from sea to sea. Brothers and sisters, what do you and I know about peace? We know more about peace by its absence than we do because of its presence. And so today the Lord Jesus Christ says to us, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am meek and I am humble of heart. You will find rest for yourselves, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And for these purposes, let us be reminded that the yoke of God is freedom, and the yoke of God is peace. Earlier this week, I was reading in the Divine Office a work by St. Peter Chrysologus, and he writes on the Beatitude, blessed are the peacemakers. And it's always a challenge to share something that's written, because sometimes things have great, great meaning for us, and when they're read, they don't seem to sometimes get off the ground. And I hope that isn't the case this morning, because there is tremendous insight in these words of St. Peter the Solomon. He says, blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are they, because this, sons of God, truly Christian virtue grows in us, and it grows in us so that we might enjoy the unchangeable possession of godly or Christian peace. It does not come with the title Son of God, but it comes to us through our being peacemakers. We are not blessed as peacemakers until we actually live out the promise, the reality of being peace. And so Chrysologus goes on saying, peace rescues you and me from servitude. Call to mind the servitude that you and I experience in this life. It provides you and me with a name of being free peace. Because if you and I are living in peace, the peace that comes from God, there is no judgment that can keep you and me in chain. A person might enchain our hands, but no one can enchain our hearts. And no one can enchain our spirits unless you and I allow someone else to do that. We are free because of the gift of God, and we are called to live in peace by the same Spirit of God. And so again, in peace, our whole identity before God, along with our human condition, is changed from our being a servant to our being a slave, to being free. Because we began our lives in freedom. We allowed ourselves to fall into sin, and we began to experience slavery. But then God constantly calls us once again to peace. Peace among brethren is the will of God. It is the joy of Christ. It is the very completeness of holiness. It is the rule of justice, the teacher of truth. It is the guardian of morals and a praiseworthy discipline in every single regard. Peace lends strength to our prayers. It is the way our petitions can reach God easily and be credited. Peace is the plenitude which fulfills every single one of our desires. Peace is the mother of love. Peace is the bond of concord. Peace is a manifest sign of a pure soul, one which seeks to please God, which seeks to be fulfilled and has his desire rewarded. Peace must be preserved according to the Lord's commands. As Christ said, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. That is, I left you in peace, and when I come back, I expect to find you in peace. As Jesus Christ left the world, he wishes to leave the gift he wanted to find when he comes back. If he were to come in this very moment, brothers and sisters, what peace could we present to him? I hope that you would not be so informed by the world that you would not know that sitting right here, participating in divine worship, hearing the word of God, preparing to receive the Eucharist of God, does not offer to you a sure and certain peace that can take you beyond the limitations of the flesh and allow you and me to live truly in the Spirit of God. St. Peter Chrysologus goes on, we have a commandment from heaven to retain his gift. His one word is, I shall find what I left. God's is the planting of peace in the root, but the uprooting is from the enemy. For just as brotherly love comes from God, so hatred comes from the devil. Therefore, we must condemn our hatred of men, for it is written, he who hates his brother is a murderer. Now you see, dearest brethren, why we should love peace and cultivate harmony, because they beget and they nurture love. But you and I know, Also from the Apostle St. John, that love comes from God, and that whoever is not with God does not possess love. Let us therefore, my sisters and my brothers, keep God's command to love, which are life for us. Let us carry on together the obligations of being brothers and sisters to one another. Let us live in profound peace, the peace that comes from God alone. Let us find one another the ties of charity in this mutual love which covers a multitude, we are told, of sin. Love ought to be embraced with a grasp of all of our desires, since the goods it provides amount to as many rewards. We must keep peace before all other virtues, since God is always in peace. Love peace, and all the world will be tranquil and quiet. By doing so, you store up rewards. We restore rewards for ourselves and for one another, so that this Church of Jesus Christ may be founded on the bond of peace and may cling to perfect observance of Christ. Brothers and sisters, let us pray during this coming week and during the rest of our lives for a perfect knowledge of God's peace and a perfect gift of peace given to us by the God's Holy Spirit. And living in that peace, may we strive for it in body and mind and spirit, so that all of us can be free, and so that all of us have a way into the kingdom of God. Amen.
Amen.
For our Church and our leaders, may they always be faithful and open to the needs of others, especially during these perilous, vulnerable, and changing times. We pray to the Lord. For an end to this pandemic, and for an end to racial and cultural injustice, violence, and strife in our nation and our world. As we approach this independence, may all the children of God experience justice with peace. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, our prayer.
For our parish, for the newly ordained priests, and for vocations to the priesthood, the diaconate, the consecrated life, and for the intentions of all gathered here, and prayed for in our book of intercessions. May God graciously hear us. For these, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our homebound and ill parishioners, may God bring them healing and strength. May they know the love and concern we have for them. We pray to the Lord. For all those celebrating birthdays, anniversaries, and special remembrances this week, may God continue to be a presence in their lives. We pray to the Lord. For the faithful departed, in particular, Gerardo Williams, the brother of Elena Morris, and Father Kenneth Westray. In their dying in Christ, may they share in his glory with all the angels and saints. We pray to the Lord.
Sisters and my brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Father Almighty. May this oblation dedicated to your name purify us, O Lord, and day by day bring our conduct closer to the light of heaven. Through Christ our Lord. May the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up, Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. But through his past Holy Spirit, he accomplished a marvelous deed by which he has freed us from the yoke of sin and death, summoning us to the glory of being now called the chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for your own possession, to proclaim everywhere your mighty works. For you have called us out of darkness into your own wonderful light. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, with all the hosts and the powers of heaven, we sing to him your glory, as without end we acclaim. Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. In a similar way, before his supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of a new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and his resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy in your presence and ministry to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and the blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, the great burden of illness and charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Wilton, our Bishop, the clergy, and the entire people you have named for your own.
Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray. That with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with St. Joseph, her most beloved spouse, with the blessed apostles, the Michael, the Archangel, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be coerced to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him. O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. There was sword and pray for every people, graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said your apostles, peace I give you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of the church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
God gives to us in this parish to be able to break bread together. People of so many races, so many languages, so much diversity, so much unity. Let us pray. Grant, we pray, O Lord, that having been replenished by such great gifts, we may gain that prize of salvation and never cease to praise you through Christ our Lord. St. Michael, the Archangel, defend us to battle, beyond protection against the wickedness and the snares of the devil. May God in him we humbly pray. And do thou, the Prince of the heavenly hosts, by the power of God, pass into thy city, and all the evil spirits will wander about the world seeking the Lord of souls. Wash you, please be seated. God, in his great mercy, has seen to it that our church has had priests to celebrate the sacraments. For this past year, with us we have had Father Santiago Martín. And this is his last Sunday here with us before going on to his next assignment at St. Bartholomew's on River Road. And so I ask you now to present again Father Santiago.
Thank you very much, Monsignor. As Monsignor already mentioned, I suppose many of you are very new, but if you didn't know, the bishop already thought to transfer me to San Bartholomew in the river in Bethesda. And I just want to say a few words, since today will be my last Mass here with you, and I will have the Spanish Mass at 1 p.m. as well. I'm very thankful to all of you, and especially to God, for the gift of the priesthood and for the gift of the church and for the gift of Christianity, first of all, because I know that to be a Christian means to be sent. And as you know, I'm from all the way from Spain, and I am aware that God has sent me here to the United States, and he has sent me also as a priest to this parish. I'm thankful to God for spending this whole year with all of you, with this parish. I'm thankful to Monsignor Tolentino for welcoming me throughout all this year. I'm very thankful also to the staff, to the choir, to the parish council, and all of you who have made possible for me this year. I realized, you know, that my priesthood doesn't have any meaning without the faithful that I serve as every day. So I just want to say thank you to all of you, and I will keep you in my prayers. You know, this year for me has been short. It has been just 1 year here to be with you, but I know that I learned a lot. You know, as the readings were saying today, Monsignor was talking about peace, and the readings were talking about being humble. You know, this for me has been a humbling year, because I learned a lot. Monsignor helped me also in many ways, also to begin to cook a little bit. You know that Monsignor cooks really well. So I could have learned many more things from him, because he knows a lot. But since the bishop has decided me to be moved, you know, I have to obey. So I also will ask you to welcome the new parochial vicar, who I know and is a very nice guy. He's more humble than me, so you will enjoy him. So I would ask you please also to welcome him. And I just want to thank you, Monsignor, and all of you for welcoming this parish. It has been a really great experience. And I know that God, our life is a mission, so we are just passing by, you know. And so I thank you, because I learned a lot from all of you. And I know that God is sending me to another parish, and they meet for another mission, because God is always in motion. So I just wanted to thank all of you, and I will keep each one of you in my prayers.
And we, hi, my name is Lisa Taylor, and I am the chair Father Santiago for his wisdom and his faith and his leadership. And so we have Christina Tan here who's gonna, can you come over, Father Santiago? So we give you a present. Thank you so much for all that you do. We wish you the best in your future. And since you're gonna be only a few miles away, we hope to see you so that we can properly have a party with not social distancing. Thank you so much. Santiago, we ask if you have a moment after Mass for you to send us to write a special note for him. That would be very kind. Thank you.